As was announced, we'll be reading from Galatians 3. Galatians 3, verses 23 through 29. That's Galatians 3, 23 through 29. I'll be reading from the New King James Version. But before faith came, we were kept under guard by the law, kept for the faith which would afterward be revealed. Therefore the law was our tutor to bring us to Christ, that we might be justified by faith. But after faith has come, we're no longer under a tutor. For you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female. For you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise.
Please keep your Bibles open there to Galatians chapter 3. You do have your Bibles, I trust. Chapter and verse divisions were made by man. But in this case, the contents of Galatians chapter 3 fits together, and the theme throughout it is continually the same, though Paul expands on some of the thoughts later on in the book as well. But we're going to be looking at chapter 3 as a whole, and hopefully it will be something beneficial as we think about problems that existed, how they were able to overcome them, and then ultimately how one becomes a Christian. And that's the main goal as we think about preaching Christ. It is to let people know how to become God's children and to live faithful lives. The churches of Galatia were a number of them, not a single place. It was an area, depending on whether you think it was southern or northern Galatia, as far as those congregations to whom Paul is now writing. In Galatians chapter 3, we begin with the section, verses 1 through 5, that deal with the foolish Galatians. They are Christians, but something is taking place and something is happening in their lives that Paul begins to write to them, "O foolish Galatians, who hath bewitched you, that ye should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ has been evidently set forth, crucified among you. This only would I learn of you. Received ye the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Are ye so foolish, having begun in the Spirit and now made perfect by the flesh? Have ye suffered so many things in vain, if it yet be in vain? He therefore that ministereth to you the Spirit and worketh miracles among you, doeth he it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith?" Paul has already warned them in chapter 1 that they should not move away from the gospel. No doubt false teachers have come in among them, and as usual, being among the Jews, they wanted to teach the law again, as we see in Acts chapter 15. They taught that circumcision was necessary in order to be saved. And yet here he is very serious about the way that he speaks to them. They need to have their eyes open and be fully aware of what's taking place, of what's going to occur if they continue down the same path. So number one, he calls them foolish. We know from Matthew chapter 7 of Jesus' teaching about the wise and the foolish builder that it is necessary to hear the truth and also to obey it if we're going to be those that are wise in contrast to those that are foolish. None of us want to appear to be foolish. None of us want to actually be foolish because of what it will cost us ultimately. When we think about the spiritual realm of losing our eternity with God. But these individuals are called foolish. But number two, he says they are bewitched. Both of these terms carry with it the idea that they are ignorant or unlearned. Here, bewitched means that they have been tricked or beguiled. They've been deceived into believing something that is simply not true. And how easy is it for us, in our plurality of spiritual teaching in our country and throughout the world, that it is for somebody to take something they think is truth, when in actuality it is nothing but disbelief. Somebody has tricked them into believing something. Well, that sounds good. Sounds reasonable. Surely that's what God wants us to do or to believe. And that's the way these Galatians were. Because they remained in that ignorant and unlearned situation, being called foolish, it was much easier for them to be tricked and to be beguiled into believing something that was not the truth. Brethren, here is the encouragement for us to read and to study. To not be those that are foolish, but rather be wise, because if we fall into the foolish category, someone is going to be able to take advantage of us spiritually and to get us to believe something that simply is not the truth. So they're foolish and they're bewitched. But he says it's because, and does cause, someone not to obey the truth. Now here, obedience to the truth isn't talking about them becoming Christians. We know from 1 Peter 1 verse 22 that same phrase is used in becoming a Christian. Seeing you have purified your souls and obeying the truth through the Spirit. Here it is, the continuation. God doesn't want us just to become Christians. Yes, that's what He wants of us, but that's not all that we need to do. Obedience to the truth is a continual process. But because these people are foolish and have been tricked or bewitched, they're now stopping their obedience to the gospel. It's as if you were driving down the interstate or just a highway, and someone for tricks put up a stop sign. It's on the straight part of the street. There's no intersections. There's nothing else that would cause you to say, I've got to stop. But spiritually, that's what's taking place with the Galatians. Somebody has stopped them, and they've chosen to believe it. They're no longer going on this journey toward heaven and eternity with God, but they've stopped. Next, he says of them this, that they have begun. Verse 3, they had the start, but they're not continuing on. In Hebrews 12, verse 2, we are to look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. What if Jesus had begun toward that cross? What if He had started on the way to dying for our sins, but decided it's too much physically for me to endure? Nobody cares if I die anyway, so what does it matter? And he stopped. These individuals have begun that race, but now they're stopping. Now, we're not talking about somebody who's physically exhausted and they can't walk or run any farther. He's talking from a spiritual standpoint that these people have just simply closed their minds to the truth. They'd rather believe something else. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2. He tells them to preach the word, be instant in season and out of season, reprove, rebuke, and exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but will be turned unto fables. These Galatians started out. They became Christians. But they're heading now in the wrong direction. And even if it is, as we say, they have now just stopped, that's just as bad. If they're not continuing on and not keeping on this journey toward heaven, then something is sadly wrong. He tells them now in verse 4, it's in vain. Have you suffered so many things in vain, if it yet be in vain? It appears that Paul is now saying there are people who are persecuting you. They're causing you to suffer because you want to or have started following Christ. But now if you stop, if you allow these people to bewitch you, if you become foolish, not only is my work in vain among you, but your attempt to start is now also in vain. As one reads through the book of Ecclesiastes, Solomon so many times uses that phrase, vanity or vexation of spirit. He says, what is it worth? If you're going to live after the world, if you're going to leave Christ, if you're not going to continue on and be faithful, what you've done so far is in vain. I don't know how many years ago it was, but as you traveled 14 going toward Wetumpka, just as you get right outside the city limit, I guess, somebody had started building a house. They put up all the 2x4s of the framing, all the walls of were put up. But that's as far as they got. Until ultimately, I guess, the 2x4s got wet enough, moist enough, that they ultimately rotted. It's not there anymore. To the Galatians spiritually, that's sort of the same thing. They had that foundation of Jesus Christ and they began, but now all of their work was in vain. Brethren, let's not allow our lives to be those that are in vain. Or the work of this congregation that may be investing in us to be in vain. But let us continue on and keep going. Next section. From foolish Galatians, we look at faithful Abraham, verses 6 through 9. Even as Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him for righteousness, know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of Abraham. And the Scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith, preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all nations be blessed. So then they which be of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham. King James uses the word heathen there in verse 8, but he's talking about the Gentiles, those that are not Jewish in their faith. So we move from these foolish Galatians to find out what the distinction is to faithful Abraham. First of all, Abraham was said to be one who believed God. In Genesis 18, verse 19, as the Lord and these two angels have appeared warning him about Sodom and Gomorrah, it says, now I know. That is, he understood. That is, God knew Abraham would not only believe, but that he would teach his children and his servants to believe in God. the answer to being foolish or bewitched or not obey is to genuinely believe, because belief is always a verb that carries with it action. It's not just a mental assent or saying, I believe this. Faith without works is dead, being alone. And so Abraham is one who is held up to these individuals as saying he had to keep going, and so must they. They can't live the life that they are stopping or going backwards. They have to keep going forward. It says then of him that it was accounted to him. A financial term, as far as someone keeping a ledger of whether someone is in the red or in the black, of financial means as far as spiritual or not. Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him that he was going to be righteous. Being righteous means he's right with God. These Galatians are not at this time in that situation. These individuals who are wanting to uphold the law, God says, look at the answer. Abraham lived before the law, and yet he was righteous without the law of Moses. He lived under the patriarchal age. And so these people who are trying to instill and enforce and say you've got to be obedient to the Old Testament law were simply wrong. Because if Abraham could be righteous before the law, then we can be righteous after the law. And for us, our belief can be accounted to righteousness as well. He speaks about Abraham's children. It's not just to the Jews. Though as we've studied in our younger classes, from Abraham to Isaac to Jacob, God continues to instill in them and give to them this promise that through you and your seed will all the nations of the world be blessed. We know that the Jewish nation came from the loins of Abraham. But we need to also understand that God had a plan to include all people in this promise to Abraham. That all the earth, and therefore everyone, can become a child of God. As Robert read just a moment ago, whether you're Jew or Greek, bond or free, male or female, there's no one set group any longer that can become the children of God, or as stated here, the children of Abraham. And we'll see more of that in a few moments. But suffice it to say right now, being a child of Abraham means that one is a child of God. These people were in danger of losing that because they wanted to instill and enforce and make people obey the Old Testament law. To Abraham, it says that he was justified, verse 8. God would justify. Now we know from the ending of Romans chapter 3 how that takes place. That Jesus is the one who justifies. That through His sacrifice, He makes it possible for us to be cleansed of our sins and to then have that right standing before God. Just as we saw from that word, account. To be justified means that we are held guiltless. That we are forgiven before God. So we move from the foolish Galatians to the faithful Abraham, to now the section that talks about the futility of the law. The futility. It doesn't mean that it did not serve a purpose, that it did not have its purpose for God to get to one point to the other. It's a longer reading, verses 10 through 18, so we'll emphasize the verses as we go through. Number one, for as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse. If you want to emphasize the law and enforce the law and tell people that they've got to obey it, you've got to obey all of it. And that was an impossibility except for the one we call Jesus. No one could keep the law completely and perfectly. And therefore, he says, the futility of the law wasn't in the law itself, but in the people who were to keep it. Because no one, in one point or another, or in many points, would fail to keep that law, and therefore they fail under the curse that came with disobedience, of being punished. So why try to get people to obey a law that held with it a curse? When Joshua brought the Israelites into the land and they began to divide it up, they came to the Jezreel Valley, and on one side was Mount Ebal and on the other side Mount Gerizim. And he said, we want you to learn this lesson. From Mount Gerizim, there was the promise of blessings. If you obey, you'll be blessed. On the other side was Mount Ebal, and it was the mount of cursing. If you disobey, you'll be punished. And here they were trying to get these people back to the Old Testament law. Oh, not completely neglecting the new, but emphasizing more the Old Testament law. And he says there is a curse that comes with it. We bring the word justified from our last section under this one, but we add a big N-O-T. Those who seek to be under the law cannot be justified. And yet they were teaching it. They were commanding people to obey it. He says, this is not possible. No man, verse 11, is justified by the law in the sight of God. Brothers and sisters, how can anyone want to borrow anything from the Old Testament and tell people to be obedient to it today? Or to bring something from the Old Testament and say, that's how we ought to worship God today? When he says that it does not provide justification in the sight of God. The Old Testament law has been removed. It is no longer our way to live or to worship before God. Jesus nailed it to the cross. It is for the Gentiles as well. Verse 14, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. If I were to ask for a show of hands, how many of you are a Gentile? I would guarantee, well, I wouldn't guarantee it, but I'd 99.99%. You'd raise your hand because you're all Gentiles just as I am. We don't have Jewish blood flowing through us. And so we ought to be thankful that God included us in His plan of salvation and that this promise to Abraham can be ours as well. Here we see the interchangeability of that word heathen and Gentiles. If you look at Acts chapter 15, you'll see that the temple was rebuilt so that the Gentiles could enter in. Not as proselytes under the Old Testament law, but as those fully acceptable in the sight of God, being able to be saved through the blood of Christ. We don't offer an animal sacrifice to find forgiveness. The blood has already been shed. It just needs to be applied. The next section he talks about quite a bit the matter of the covenant. Brethren, I speak after the manner of men. Though it be but a man's covenant, yet it is confirmed, no man disannulleth. So he borrows from everyday life and says, if two come to an agreement, and it's confirmed, both say, yes, this is what it should be. Nobody's going to be able to come along later and say, let's break it. Disannulled. Or add something there too. So he moves that to the importance of the spiritual. Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He saith not, and to seeds as of many, but as of one, and to thy seed, which is Christ. This I say, that the covenant was confirmed before of God in Christ. When was that done? Before the law. 430 years, and it can't disannul it. That is, the promise, the covenant made to Abraham that God would bless through the seed, not even the law can add to it or take from it. It can't disannul it. So that he shows us that it cannot be made of none effect. Verse 17. For if the inheritance be of the law, it is no more of promise. Once more, emphasize, and it may be, you think, beating a dead horse. If we want the promise that God made, we cannot follow the Old Testament law, because it removes that promise. The final section, the faith that came. The final verses, 20 through 29, speaks about a faith that is able to save. The faith that he says we must live by. Number one, he says it was added. Now a mediator is not a mediator of one, but God is one. Is the law then against the promises? God forbid. For if there had been a law given which could have given life, verily righteousness should have been by the law. But the Scripture hath concluded all under sin, that the promise by faith of Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe. But before faith came, the faith that Paul speaks about in Romans 1 verse 5, that which is preached about Jesus Christ, His death, burial, and resurrection for us to be saved. That's the faith that he says that came. We were kept under the law, shut up unto the faith which should afterwards be revealed. So you have Abraham with the promise, you have the law of Moses, and now you have the faith that came. He's talking about the New Testament. It came so that we might see the need of this seed. Not of seeds as of many. The promise to Abraham would be his descendants would be like the sand and the stars, which are in the billions and billions. But he says there's one that gives us the faith. And that's the seed, Jesus Christ. But he says the law was our schoolmaster. Robert read from the New King James and it used the word tutor. And that's not even really an appropriate word either, any more than schoolmaster. From about 6:30 in the morning, at least for a few more days, till somewhere around 7, there's this bright yellow vehicle that comes, probably 3 or 4 of them, I guess, by the house. A school bus. It's the one that takes the children from their home to the school. A schoolmaster and a tutor, we think more about the school itself and the teachers. But the law is a school bus. It's the one that moves from Abraham as the law to the faith that came. Just as those kids get on the bus at their house, they get off of it. They don't just get on it and continually ride and ride and ride and ride. The law wasn't meant to continue on. It was meant to get us to Jesus Christ, to that faith that we can have in Him. So whether it's schoolmaster or tutor, still doesn't give us really the right concept. You may have another translation that uses a different phrase, but those two don't really fit, because it's the moving of those from one spot to another. And that was the purpose of the law. It was never, ever, ever meant to be a continuing law. It was meant to get us from that promise to the answer of that promise, the faith in Christ that came. So we are no longer under that schoolmaster. The faith that came teaches us how do we get into Jesus Christ. Notice, if you would, verses 26 and 27. For ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. No longer under the schoolmaster, the tutor. That's the past. Verse 26 is a present tense statement. You are presently the children of God. How did that come about? Something in the past took place. For as many of you as have been. I have been in 12th grade. That was 1976. I'm no longer there. These people have been baptized, something that occurred earlier. A past event, being baptized into Christ, makes them presently the children of God. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. And that's the answer to this promise. There is neither Jew nor Greek, bond nor free, male nor female, for you are all one in Christ. When it comes to the matter of salvation or the fulfillment of this promise, everyone can be a part. And if you be Christ, then are you Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. The congregation here has experienced a number of deaths lately. It wasn't my family. And so I'm not expecting to go to that and say, hey, where's my inheritance? But this promise that is made to Abraham is a promise that everyone can be a part of. Heirs according to the promise. Why is it important to study the Old Testament? Because it's back there that God began to make that promise for this faith to come. So when we read in Romans 1 verse 17, that from faith to faith, he's talking about a move from a faith to the faith that came. We may not, in this life, get much of an inheritance from those who've gone before us. We may not physically expect much or get much. But to be an heir of this promised Abraham means that every one of us can have our sins forgiven. Unless we're foolish like the Galatians and allow someone to come along and to trick and to beguile us into believing and following or stopping altogether. This morning, there's neither Jew nor Greek, bond or free, male or female. Everyone can be saved if I choose or if you choose to come in contact with the blood of Christ. Through faith, repentance, confession of Christ, we are baptized into Christ. Verse 27. And then become the children of God. And heirs according to all that God has promised. Ultimately, eternity. If this morning you're not a Christian, you don't know what you're missing. But what is sadder is if we're like the Galatians and we've begun and then we stop. Peter says the latter end is worse for them than the beginning. If you're not faithfully living for Christ, if you've allowed sin or false doctrine to corrupt your life, realize what you're missing out on and will miss out on. In repentance and confession of our faults, our sins, our brethren can pray for us, and God's faithful and just to forgive us. If this morning you're subject to our Lord's invitation, please come as we stand and sing.
We're Amen.